Okay, good morning everyone. Today we will continue our discussion on top-down parsing. So just to recall, so right now we are studying the theory of parsing. Okay, this is where we are. One important thing that we have seen in the last class is how we can use symbol table. Okay, how we can use symbol table to resolve certain context sensitive ambiguities during the parsing phase. Okay, and we have also seen that we can specify the syntactic structure of various programming languages using context-free grammars. For example, so the grammar GC could be the context-free grammar for the C programming language, and then you may have another context-free grammar GC++ for C++ programming language, and you may have another context-free grammar GJava for Java programming language, so on and so forth. And the question before us is, given a program such as let's say sort.cpp, which is a C++ program, we want to check, the parser wants to check whether this program belongs to the language described by the GC++ grammar, or in other words, whether the program satisfies the syntactic structure specified by the context-free grammar associated with the C++ programming language. So this is the question that we are trying to address. So generally speaking, so given a string W, we want to check whether the string W belongs to the language described by the context-free grammar G. This is the question which the theory of parsing tries to address. So here, again, so the question is this, whether the string W belongs to the language described by the context-free grammar G. So there is an algorithm called a CYK algorithm, which can construct the parse tree for a given string, but it takes a cubic time in the worst case. And then there is another algorithm called as Erlis algorithm. It also takes n cube time for parsing for general context-free grammars, but if the grammar is unambiguous, then it takes a quadratic time. So quadratic time, the grammar is unambiguous. But we are not happy with quadratic time algorithms. So we want to see if we can come up with a linear time algorithm for parsing a given program. So this is our goal. The goal is to come up with a linear time algorithm. Okay, so this is our goal. Okay. So, and the key idea here moving towards a linear time algorithm is, if we design the syntactic rules, okay, if we design the syntactic rules of a programming language carefully, then we may not require the full non-deterministic power of context-free grammars. Okay. So, in the context of context-free grammars, so we have context-free languages, and these context-free languages can be specified using context-free grammars. And these context-free grammars, for every context-free grammar, we can construct a associated non-deterministic pushdown automata. Okay. Till this point, the equivalence holds good. Okay. But then non-deterministic pushdown automata is not equivalent to deterministic pushdown automata. So this equivalence is not there. And this is where the challenge in coming up with linear time parsing algorithms come into picture. Okay. But the idea here is, we if we kind of make the syntactic structure of our programming languages nice and simple, then we will be able to, then we might be able to parse those the programs from those languages using linear time parsing algorithms. Okay. On the contrary, just to put the things into context, so we have regular languages, and these regular languages, they can be described using regular expressions, and these regular expressions, they are equivalent to NFAs, and these NFAs are equivalent to DFAs. So in the case of finite automata, so NFAs and DFAs are equivalent. That is, we can eliminate or remove non-determinism in a finite automata by trading off with more number of states. But in the context of PDAs, non-deterministic PDAs, they are not equivalent to deterministic PDAs. There are broadly two parsing techniques. One is called as top-down parsing technique. The other is called as a bottom-up parsing technique. Top-down parsing technique is good for hand-coded parsers. Okay, and bottom-up parsing technique is good for parsers generated by automatic parser generators. Okay. Well, if you, but there is a small, you have to take this with a pinch of salt, because the Antler parser generator that you are using, the Antler parser generator that you are using, it generates a top-down parser. Okay, so top-down parsing is not only good for hand-coded parsing, but even you can use top-down parsing techniques in parser generators. Okay, so not only this, you can use these techniques in parser generators too. Having said that, definitely top-down parsing technique is more amenable if you want to write a hand-coded parser. Okay, so recall our in our discussion on lexical analysis, we were looking at two approaches for writing a lexical analyzer. One is hand-code the lexical analyzer. Okay, the other is use a lexical analyzer generator tool such as Flex or Antler. Okay. So similarly, in the context of parsing also, it is possible for us to either use hand-coded parsers, that is, you directly go ahead and write a C or C++ program. So if you are doing that, so writing a top-down parser is easier, definitely easier. But if you want to take the path of using a parser generator such as Antler or Bison, Bison is another example of a parser generator. Okay, then usually both, in which case both top-down parsers parsing or bottom-up parsing techniques could be useful. Like for example, Bison generates parsers which do bottom-up parsing, whereas Antler generates parsers which do top-down parsing. Okay. So let's see what is the difference between top-down parsing versus bottom-up parsing. So in top-down parsing, so what we do is we start with a root node, okay? And we construct the derivation starting from the root node. And during that process, we construct a leftmost derivation for a given input stream. Like for example, let's say the grammar that we have here is this, and this is the input string, ID plus ID, is the string we want to check. We want to check if that string is described by the given context-free grammar. Okay, so we start with the root node E, and then we use the substitution rule E goes to E plus T. That is the first step of derivation. Okay, and then after that, we pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol, and then we use the substitution rule E goes to T. Okay, and so the next intermediate form is this. So here E goes to And then the next substitution rule that we use is T goes to F. So this is what is happening here. Okay. So if you see, as the derivation process is going on, the lower fringe of the parse tree, what is the lower fringe of the parse tree? This is the lower fringe of the parse tree. Okay. Let me. The lower fringe of the parse tree is nothing but if you take a look at all the leaf nodes. So one is F plus T. This constitutes the lower fringe of the parse tree. The lower fringe of the parse tree gives the intermediate sentential form in the process of the leftmost derivation. Okay. And then we apply the substitution rule F goes to ID, and we get this. This is the lower fringe right now. ID, F, and T is the lower fringe. And that corresponds to the current left sentential form, ID plus T. Okay. So like this, we construct the complete parse tree. So now the parse tree construction is over. And if you look at the leaves of the parse tree, they are all terminal symbols. And when we put all the leaves together, it's nothing but the input stream. So hence the parse tree that is constructed is a valid parse tree for the given input string, and hence the input string is a valid input string, okay, described by the context tree grammar. Okay, so now let's see how the same thing is done using bottom-up parsing technique. So in bottom-up parsing technique, so the top-down parsing technique is very intuitive. So if I don't tell you anything about the theory of parsing, if I just give you a grammar, and then ask you to come up with an algorithm to check whether a given input string belongs to the language described by the grammar, you may possibly come up with top-down parsing approach. But the bottom-up parsing approach is a bit unintuitive, okay? So it requires a bit of time to understand exactly what is going on there. So in bottom-up parsing, we start with the bottom of the parse tree and try to construct the tree upwards. And in terms of derivation, so we start with the string and we want to go back and try to arrive at the start symbol. So we want to discover the derivation also in the reverse fashion. So in top-down parsing, we are discovering the derivation in a forward fashion. Whereas in the bottom-up parsing, we want to discover the derivation in the reverse order. So we start with ID plus ID, that is the given input string. Then what we do is we apply what is called as a reduction operation. So you reduce ID to F by using the substitution rule, F goes to ID. You use that substitution rule to reduce ID to F. So this is what is happening. So here we are moving from ID to F. So now if you look at the upper fringe of the parse tree, so the upper fringe is, the current upper fringe is F plus ID. So the upper fringe of the parse tree corresponds to the current intermediate sentential form, okay? And then the next step is, what happened? Yeah. And the next step is, so again, you reduce, you apply, you use the substitution rule, T goes to F, and you move from here to here, okay? So again, if you look at the current upper fringe, okay, this is the current upper fringe. This current upper fringe T plus ID, it corresponds to this intermediate right sentential form, okay? And then again, we use the substitution rule, E goes to T, and we apply the reduction operation. That is, T reduces to E. Okay, so we keep going like this. So finally, we construct the parse tree. Okay, so if you think about this bottom-up parsing approach, you could be wondering on what basis we are able to choose in each step of the derivation how to move from here to here, for example. Okay, so how did we choose here that we have to reduce id to f? How did we choose here? Okay, an important idea here is we are constructing the derivation, or we are discovering the derivation in the reverse fashion. Okay, and the derivation that we discover in the bottom up parsing is a rightmost derivation. Okay, whereas the derivation that we discover in top down parsing, it is a leftmost derivation. All right. So to summarize, there are two kinds of parsers: top down parsers. Within top down parsers, we have a couple of parsers, LL1 parsers and recursive descent parsers. And the idea here is you start at the root of the parse tree and you grow towards the leaves. And at every step, this is the first step. Okay, this is the first idea. And then you pick a production and you try to match the input. And if we choose the wrong substitution rule to expand a non-terminal symbol, then we may end up doing backtracking. Okay, so this is an important problem, or this is the most important problem that we would like to solve in while designing a top-down parser. Okay, so our goal is to come up with a backtrack-free parser. Okay, backtrack-free parser. So that is our goal. For the next couple of classes, we will study the theory of top-down parsing. Bottom-up parsers, we will take them up later. To gain intuition on bottom-up parsers, it requires a bit of an effort. It's not straightforward. So we will leave bottom-up parsers at that right now, and we will revisit it later. Okay. So this picture is important. So we have all the context-free languages described by the outer square, and there are languages which are not LR1 parsable. So there are languages here. What is LR1 parsable? So LR1 means, so all bottom-up parsers, we call them as LR1 parsers, okay, or LRK parsers also. So there are context-free languages which are not bottom-up parsable. So there are languages here which are not bottom-up parsable. Okay, but these languages, you can either parse them, okay, using the CYK algorithm, okay, which takes theta of n cube time. So CYK algorithm, if I'm right, it is based on, it's a dynamic programming. Based approach. And then, or you can use Ehrlich's algorithm, okay. So depending upon the grammar, so if the grammar is ambiguous, then maybe the algorithm takes a cubic time. But if the grammar is unambiguous, then the grammar takes a quadratic time. Okay, this is for unambiguous grammar. So these are the approaches to handle languages which fall here. But there are languages but if the language falls here, then we can use LR1 parsing techniques. So you can use bottom-up parsing techniques. But the important thing is there are languages which are LR1 parsable or bottom-up parsable, but not LL1 parsable. Okay, so all these are the languages which are here in this space. So they are all LR1 parsable, but they are not LL1 parsable. And then there are some languages which fall here. So any language which falls here, it is LL1 or top-down parsable. LL1 parsable. Okay, so LL1 parsability means that is you will be able to parse the language in top-down fashion without backtracking. So if you allow backtracking, then every language is top-down parsable. Okay, so LL1 parsability means, so you do top-down parsing, so making it clear, so top-down parsing. No backtracking. And there are some languages which are regular, okay, but are not LL1 parsable, okay. So these are our simple regular languages. So and these regular grammars or regular languages, they are only useful to specify the micro syntax of programming languages. They are not useful to specify the macro syntax of programming languages. So regular grammars, they are good for only micro syntax. Okay, not for macro syntax. But whereas LL1 grammars, they are useful. You can specify the macro syntax. In fact, you know, like the Antler parser, the parser which Antler tool generates, it is a variant of LL1 parser. Okay, it's a variant of LL1 parser. Okay, so this is the summary picture. So now we will focus our attention on top-down parsing and specifically what is called as a recursive descent approach. Okay, so here the idea is given an input string, this is the goal. We want to discover a derivation. So given an input string, we want to discover a derivation or a parse tree for it. Okay. So, and what is the approach? What is the main idea? At every step of derivation, let's say we are at the ith step. Okay. So we are at the ith step and we want to move from this particular sentential form to this particular sentential form. And remember, these sentential forms, they belong to, so they are strings over terminal and non-terminal symbols. Okay. So we pick a non-terminal symbol from the sentential form gamma I minus 1. Okay. And then we apply a substitution rule. Okay. And in top-down parsing, among the non-terminal symbols that are available, in the substitution in the sentential form gamma I minus 1, we pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol. Okay. And the second question, of course, though, is once we pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol for expansion, which substitution rule we would like to apply. Okay. So here is the challenge. So if you don't choose the right substitution rule, okay, then we may have to backtrack later on, okay? And the important idea here is there are certain context-free grammars, which we call them as LL1 grammars. We can design a backtrack-free parser, okay? So again, here to summarize top-down parsing, we start with the start symbol. We keep expanding the parse tree. At any point of time, if you just look at the leaves of the parse tree, then they are labeled either with terminal symbols or non-terminal symbols. And we pick the leftmost leaf node, which is labeled by a non-terminal symbol. Like for example, here, this is the lower fringe of the parse tree. Okay, so here, so what we have here is the lower fringe of the parse tree. In the lower fringe of the parse tree, so what we are doing is we are picking the leftmost non-terminal symbol A. So since A is the leftmost non-terminal symbol, whatever the all the leaves that are present before A, so they are all terminal symbols. So a string of terminal symbols, we denote it by lowercase alphabet towards the end, like U, V, W, etc. Okay. And then, so after the non-terminal symbol A, you have a string of symbols, and these symbols, they are either terminal symbols or non-terminal symbols, okay? So this is the current state of parsing. So from S, in one or more steps, we are able to derive this intermediate sentential form UA alpha, where U is a string of terminal symbols and A is a non-terminal symbol and alpha belongs is a string over terminal and non-terminal symbols. I want you to clearly understand this notation and what this U means, what this A means and what alpha means. Okay, and then so we expand, so once we pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol A, we expand it using one of the substitution rules. Okay, like for example, so associated with A, there can be two substitution rules, A goes to alpha 1 or A goes to alpha 2. So you try with the first substitution rule, A goes to alpha 1, and see if there is a, if you are able to successfully construct a derivation or a parse tree. If there is a problem, you have to backtrack and then you have to try out the next substitution rule, A goes to alpha 2. Okay. So if there is an input mismatch, okay, so backtrack and try another production. Try another production. So these are the important ideas. Okay, let's keep going. So let's take an example and understand this idea of backtracking. So this is a grammar that we have seen in the last class. For the sake of succinctness, so we will use first letters. And also, in order to understand this example, so we just E goes to E plus T or E minus T or T. And term goes to factor. I'm just ignoring term divided by F on the right hand side because we don't need it to understand this example. Okay. So let's use this shorthand notation for this grammar and see how we parse this input string using a top-down parsing approach with respect to this grammar. Okay. So let's get started. So we start here. So from here to here, when we are moving from here to here, we use the substitution rule, G goes to E. Okay, and this is what we are doing here. Okay. And then we use the substitution rule, EXPR goes to EXPR plus term, that is, so here we are using E goes to E plus 2. This is the substitution rule that we are using. And the input pointer is here. Right now the input pointer is here. Okay. So what we do is we keep going like this. And at some point we construct this parse tree. Okay. We keep expanding the parse tree. And this is the lower fringe of the parse tree. Okay. So till this point, till this line, okay, there is no way to check whether what you are doing is right or wrong, okay, till this point, till this line. But after line, after this line, you have generated this first terminal symbol IDX, okay. So now what you do is you compare this IDX, the terminal symbol here, with the next input symbol in the input stream. Okay, with the next token in the input stream. So there is a match. Okay, so you generated an identifier and then in the input also, so we have X, X is an identifier. So there is a match. So what you do is you advance the input pointer from here to here and then you go here. And then you have the minus symbol here. And then you compare this minus with plus. Okay, and it's not a match. So that means the derivation process that we use, the substitution that you have used at some point in the derivation process, it's not working out. So you have to try a different substitution. So what you do is, so you backtrack. So you backtrack. So from here, you go back here, okay? And then you want to try out a different substitution. So here, so you go back here. So this is the place where you have backtracked to, and then now you use a different substitution rule. Earlier you used, so in the earlier you used E goes to E plus T, But now you want to use e goes to e minus t. This is the substitution rule you would like to use. So you use this e goes to e minus t, and then you continue the process of derivation. And then, so let's say again we are here. Okay, we are here. So because at this point it is possible for us to check whether the generated input symbol, not the input symbol, the generated token or the generated symbol matches the current input symbol. So IDX matches identity, the current, the token that is generated is ID, and it matches. So X is also an identifier. So what you do is you advance the pointer. Okay, so you advance it here, and then in the next step you compare this minus with this minus. Again there is a match. Okay, so now, so after that, and then you move this to here. So this is the place, this is the current position of the input pointer, and this is the current state of the left sentential form. So the story is successful so far. Okay, so this is the partial parse tree that is constructed, and the partial parse tree that is constructed so far conforms to the input prefix. This is the prefix x minus. Till this point, it is conforming. Okay, so this is the input. So this input prefix conforms to the parse tree that has been generated so far. So we are happy. Okay, so we are happy and we want to proceed further. So now what we do is we pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol term and we want to expand it. So here when we want to expand a term, so remember there are three substitution rules for term. One is T star F, the other is T F, and other is factor. Okay, so these are the three substitution rules. So let's say we have used the third substitution rule, term goes to factor. Okay, so this is what happens when term goes to factor. So from here, we move here. And then, so factor has multiple substitution rules. One is okay. So remember, factor is this, or this. So let's say we have used factor goes to num. Okay, so factor goes to num. So this is the generated parse tree. So if you see the parse tree generated, it is complete. There are no more non-terminal symbols to match. So now, so what happens is the current input symbol is here. So you match this two with, which is a number with the token type here, and there is a match grid. So you advance it to the next position. So when you advance it to the next position, so what happens is the next input symbol is star, but then there is nothing there in the parse tree to match star against. So there is a problem. Okay, so the substitution rule that we have used, term goes to factor, is not working out. So we have to backtrack. So we have to backtrack here. So again, when we backtrack, so we use a different substitution rule, that is term goes to T star F. Okay, and then we do all the derivation process here. Okay, and this is the resulting parse tree. So now after this, you can, so after this, like for example, here at line, so now you can check the whatever the fringe of the parse tree matches the input. Okay, so the point here is if you use the wrong substitution rule or if you don't use the right substitution rule in the discovery of parse tree, we have to keep backtracking, and backtracking is a very expensive operation. So you may end up having exponential time algorithm to parse a input string if you just keep backtracking. So you go forward, you come back, you go forward, you come back, and it is pretty bad. Okay, so we want to come up with, so the idea behind this example is how this backtracking works and how it is an expensive operation, and how the next set of ideas are how we can go about eliminating backtracking. Okay, but before we do this, let's try to understand how we can design a recursive descent parser, okay, where backtracking is permitted or where backtracking happens. Okay, so because once we understand how such a recursive descent parser is designed, then it is possible to come up with a strategy to eliminate backtracking. Okay, so given a grammar, how can we go about designing a recursive descent parser where it is already to have backtracking? Okay, so what we do is, associated with every non-terminal symbol, we construct a function. Like for example, if A is a non-terminal symbol, then associated with the non-terminal symbol A, we pick a function. Okay, so we have a function. And then in the step one, we choose a production associated with A. Okay, so step one is tricky. So how do we pick the production associated with A? In the case of non-deterministic pushdown automata, you magically pick the right substitution rule or the right production rule. Okay, let's say that magic, we have that magic available to us. What is that magic? The power of non-determinism, that we magically pick the right substitution rule. Okay, so here, so there is a magic. So non-deterministic, so non-determinism, I'll say, so we magically do this step. Okay, and then so what we do is, so we have a for loop which calls if xi is a non-terminal, which iterates from 1 to k, and if the symbol xi is a non-terminal symbol, then we call the procedure xi. Okay, so think of it this way. So let's say this is your parse tree, and this is the non-terminal symbol that you are working with. So we have magically picked the substitution rule, A goes to X1 to XK. So let's say if X1 is a terminal symbol, you check whether X1 and the current input string W is equal to U, A, V, and this is U. Okay, so you check whether this X1 matches A. Okay, if X1 matches A, if X1 is a terminal symbol and if X1 matches A, you advance the input pointer, and also here you move from X1 to X2. Okay, on the contrary, okay, if X1 is a non-terminal symbol, then you call the procedure associated with X1. Okay, and that will lead to the generation of a parse subtree associated with the non-terminal symbol X1. Okay, and what is the third case? X1 is not a non-terminal symbol, it is a terminal symbol, and it is not equal to the current input symbol A, in which case we generate an error. Okay, so there is a parsing error, so we generate an error. So like this, for all the non-terminal symbols in the context-free grammar, we have a function which does these steps. And the most interesting step here is step one, where we magically pick a appropriate substitution rule. So if you want to eliminate this magic, okay, so what you do is you iterate through all the substitution rules. You first try your substitution rule one. If it works, it's great. If it doesn't work, you try the second substitution rule, and so on and so forth. So during this process of trying out one substitution rule after another substitution rule, you end up doing a lot of backtracking. So you need to have a backtracking logic in your recursive descent parser. Okay. Let's keep going. So for example, so let's take this example, simple grammar. S goes to A or B. A or B are non-terminal symbols. each non-terminal symbol A has two alternate substitution rules. So let's say, so there is a variable called as associated with the start symbol S, there is a function S. And there is what is called as a buff pointer, that is a global variable. So this is your input string W. And currently, if this is the current input that we are, current input symbol that we have to consume, buff pointer points to this. Okay, so what do we do? So S has two alternatives. So it first tries to parse the input string by using the substitution rule A. How does it try this? It calls the function A, it calls the function associated with the non-terminal symbol A. So, and if the function returns a success, then it checks whether the input is completely consumed. Okay, it could be the case that, you know, A returns success but consumes only part of the input. Okay, and then it's a problem. So it checks whether the string is described by the non-terminal symbol A by calling the function A. If it's a success, it also checks whether the whole input string is consumed, in which case it says that the string is a valid string described by the context-free grammar. Let's say if it doesn't work, then what happens is A could have advanced the input pointer, buff pointer, by some amount. So this is not working out. So what you have to do is you have to backtrack. Okay, so you backtrack to its the original position, and then again you try out the next substitution and the same check you do. So if both these things fail, that is if you are not able to describe the input string using the first substitution rule or the second substitution rule, then you return fail. Then that means the input string is not a valid string described by the context-free grammar. Now let's see how the functions A and B are designed. Okay, so now let's take a look at A. So again, A, when it is about to consume the input, it stores the current buff pointer in a temporary position. Okay, so this is buff pointer. Okay, buff pointer is this. So you store it in the variable temp buff pointer, and then it tries to consume or parse the input using the first substitution. Okay, so associated with the first substitution rule, there is a function called as A underscore one, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, so if it is a success, then it just returns success. If A1 returns failure, then what happens is you backtrack. You backtrack and then you try the second substitution rule. The same is the case with B also. Okay, the function associated with the non-terminal B, it tries to pass the input using the function B1, that is using the first substitution rule. And if it doesn't work, it backtracks, and then it tries out the second substitution rule. If it doesn't work, it backtracks, and then finally, if both of them doesn't work, it returns a failure. Okay, so let's see how A1 looks like. So if you look at A1, remember, what is A1? So A1 is the substitution rule 0, A1. So what happens is, so the non-terminal symbol is trying out whether it can match a prefix of the input using the substitution rule 0A1. In order to match a prefix of the input starting from buff pointer, the first symbol has to be equal to 0. If this first symbol is not equal to 0, then know that substitution rule, this particular substitution rule, doesn't work. Okay, so it returns a failure. But if it matches, then what happens is it advances the buff pointer by 1, and then so it has to check whether a prefix of the input can be matched by the non-terminal symbol A. So it calls A again. So there is a recursive function call here. Okay. So finally, after that, it checks after it returns from the function call A successfully. Then it checks whether the next input is 1, because the substitution rule is 0A1. Okay, so if it works, it's great. Otherwise, then what happens is it has to backtrack. So if it doesn't work, so here you are doing the backtracking. Okay, so here you are doing backtracking. So whenever there is a failure, okay, you have to backtrack. So this is the place where you do backtrack. Okay, this. So that's it. So this is how you can design a recursive descent parser with backtracking. Okay, and it is quite possible. No, given how we are writing, how the code is structured, so it is. You can think of a parser generator. You can think of coming up with a program which takes grammar as input and generates all this code automatically or algorithmically or mechanically. So it is. So the first idea is, we can automatically or algorithmically recursive descent parsers with backtracking. So this is the first idea. So let's move on. So what are the problems with recursive descent parsing? So for example, if you see this grammar, E goes to E plus T. So recursive descent parsing approach doesn't work with this grammar. That is because we have E goes to E plus T. You pick the leftmost non-terminal symbol, which is G, and then again you apply the substitution rule, E goes to E plus T. So you keep on going like this. So the parser doesn't terminate. So this is what is called as a left recursion. So what you are seeing here is what is called as a left recursion. Okay. So grammars with left recursion, so they are not amenable for recursive descent parsing. So we have to fix this left recursion problem. Okay, so when do we say that a grammar has left recursion? So if there is a derivation which starts from A, in one or more steps, it generates another intermediate form, A alpha, then we say that the grammar is left recursion. And what happens is during the process of derivation, let's say you have, this is your parse tree, and you have your A here, and then after some time, after a process of derivation, what happens is you will get an A here and you will have alpha here. And then again, what happens is again, you will generate a tree of the same structure. So you have alpha here and then you keep going like that. So because of that, the grammar it never terminates. Okay, so the parsing process never terminates. Okay, so we have to convert. On the contrary, on the other side, without recursion, you cannot express the structure of programming languages. Okay, so you have to convert the left recursion into right recursion. Okay, and that's what we do. So like, for example, if you have two substitution rules, if you have a substitution rule like this, okay, so A goes to A alpha, and then you can apply again A goes to A alpha. So A goes to alpha, and finally beta alpha. So if you think about it, if you have a pair of substitution rules such as this, then the kind of strings that will be generated is beta alpha star. Okay. So the way we generate so this is our goal. We should be able to generate intermediate forms which can be described by this so-called regular expression. It is strictly not a regular expression because beta and alpha are strings over nt and t, that is alpha and beta. So this is strictly not a regular expression, but this is, you can call it as a generalized regular expression. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to rewrite this grammar so that we will be able to generate strings such as this. So what is the idea? The strings that are described by this so-called regular expression they have the structure beta, beta alpha, beta alpha alpha, so on and so forth. So what we do is we have this first substitution rule here, this rewritten grammar, which says A goes to beta A prime, okay? Generate all strings which starts with beta. And what is A prime? A prime can be a null string or alpha A prime, okay? So that's it. So these three substitution rules, they describe, okay, they successfully generate all the strings from this set. But at the same time, there is no left recursion involved in this, but instead we have a right recursion. Okay, so that's the core idea. We can generalize this idea. So let's say you have a set of substitution rules such as this. Okay, we have a set of substitution rules such as this. So here you can see A goes to A alpha 1, A goes to A alpha 2, all these substitution rules, they result in left recursion. But if you see the language described, okay, the set of strings that are generated by these substitution rules, they can be summarized by this so-called regular expression. This is not really a regular expression because alphas and betas, they are not terminal symbols, okay? But they do tell us what is the structure of the strings that are generated. That is, any string that is generated by the substitution rule, it either starts with beta 1 or beta 2 or beta m, okay, followed by any combination of alpha i's. That is, for example, so you can say, let me take an eraser. Good. So we have, for example, A goes to A alpha 2. Okay, and then you can say A goes to A alpha 1, alpha 2, and then you can say A goes to alpha 4, alpha 1, alpha 2, and then finally we terminate A by using, let's say, beta 3, alpha 4, alpha 1, alpha. So if you see any string that is generated starting from A, it starts with either beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, so on and so forth, okay? Followed by zero or more alpha i's. And these alpha i's can be any combination. How do we represent this set of strings? So you rewrite the substitution rules by saying A goes to beta 1 A prime. That is, a string generated by A, it can start with beta 1, okay? Or it can start with beta 2, or it can start with beta 3, or it can start with beta n. And after this beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, so on and so forth, you have any arbitrary string formed from alpha 1 to alpha n. And how do you describe them? You use the substitution rules. A prime goes to alpha 1 A prime, alpha 2 A prime, so on and so forth, alpha n A prime, and epsilon. If you see the strings generated by A prime, they are of this form. So alpha 2 A prime. You can have alpha 2, alpha 3, A prime. And finally, you can use epsilon here, and then you can terminate this. Okay? Like, for example, if you want to generate beta 3 goes to alpha 4, alpha 1, let's see how we can do using the modified grammar. That will help you understand what is going on. So what do you do? So you have, you use the substitution rule, A goes to beta 3 A prime, okay? And then what you do is beta 3 alpha 4 A prime, okay? So beta 3 alpha 4 alpha 1 A prime, okay? So beta 3 alpha 4 alpha 1 alpha 2 A prime. And then finally, you use A prime goes to null and terminate this derivation process. So it is possible for us to eliminate left recursion in the grammar and make it into a right recursive grammar by performing what is called as a grammar transformation. So what we did is what is called as a grammar transformation. Okay. So I want you to take this grammar. This grammar is left recursive, and eliminate left recursion from this grammar, and you will figure out that you will end up getting the following grammar. So I would like you to try this out and check whether the grammar here is a valid grammar, conforms to the grammar that is given on the top left corner. Okay, so the grammar on the top left corner, it is a left recursive grammar. The grammar below, it is a right recursive grammar, but it describes the same language. So again, this is a homework problem. So finally, I would like to conclude this class with a slightly more involved idea. So what we have seen before, so it is what is called as a direct self recursion. Direct left recursion. So E goes to E plus T or T. You can see that just by looking at this substitution rule, you can see that there is a left recursion. But on the contrary, if you see the example one, you don't see any left recursion directly, okay? Because S goes to this substitution rule followed by B, and A goes to this substitution rule, so on and so forth. So you don't see any left recursion directly. But then if you follow this derivation process that S goes to AA and you replace the non-terminal symbol A with SD, then you will see that this S is occurring in the left again. So what happens is if you continue this process, so you will end up something like this. Okay, so what is A, SD? Okay, so on and so forth. So this is the case where in one or more steps, we got this. So this is what is called as an indirect left recursion. Similarly, in the example two also, there is a indirect left recursion. So what is the indirect left recursion here? S goes to B and B goes to SP. Okay, so in one or more steps, we are able to discover this, and this is a problematic case. Okay, so handling indirect left recursion is slightly more involved than handling direct left recursion. So we will not look into the algorithm. So this algorithm is there in the book. I would like you to read the algorithm and understand it. Okay, so that's all for today. If you have any questions, I will take now.